Bienvenidas a todos y todas al décimo ciclo de conferencias caribeñas. A nombre del Instituto de Estudios del Caribe, su personal y estudiantes ayudantes de investigación, le damos la más cordial bienvenida y le agradecemos estar aquí personal y virtualmente. Las conferencias caribeñas son auspiciadas por la oficina del decano interino de la Facultad de Ciencias Sociales, el doctor Jorge Duani. Y queremos reconocer el apoyo de la Biblioteca Regional del Caribe y de la Unidad de Radio y Televisión de la UPR, el compañero Claudio Putnam y Wanda Aponte. En la entrada tenemos una exhibición de nuestra revista Caribbean Studies, la primera en estar en la importante base de datos JSTOR, y afuera tenemos una exhibición de la colección ¿cómo que se llama? Ediciones Callejón. Ediciones Callejón. No, porque ahora te levanté todo el interés. Este es el evento número 122 de las conferencias caribeñas que comenzaron en el 2007. Qué vergüenza, ¿verdad? No ha sido fácil, las mías se han celebrado gracias a la colaboración de los investigadores del Instituto de Estudios del Caribe, el doctor Feli Ojeda, Ana Fabián, Dale Matthews y el trabajo del personal no docente, Ovidio Torres, Oscar Mendoza, Naya Menéndez, José Hernández y Juan Luis Martínez. Estos dos últimos por compensación. Porque el Instituto de Estudios del Caribe no tiene secretaria ni oficial administrativo de hace más de 5 años. La cooperación de los estudiantes Nancy Arocho y Clemente Rodríguez también ha sido muy importante. Les solicitamos que por favor apaguen sus celulares y que en el periodo de preguntas y comentarios se identifiquen por motivo de la grabación en video. Ahora les presentamos a la doctora Astrid Cubano, profesora del Departamento de Historia, que gentilmente ha aceptado presentar a la ponente, a la doctora Rebeca Escota, a quien le damos la bienvenida. Y el instituto le reitera su agradecimiento por su participación en esta actividad número 122. Gracias.
Buenas tardes, bienvenidos. Me complace presentarles a la doctora Rebeca Scott, profesora de la Universidad de Michigan en Ann Arbor, donde ocupa la cátedra profesora distinguida Charles Gibson en el Departamento de Historia, donde también se desempeña como profesora permanente de la Escuela de Leyes. Nos honra Rebeca Scott con su visita en la feliz ocasión de la presentación de su libro traducido al español, Grados de Libertad, Cuba y Luisiana después de la esclavitud, el cual publica ahora Ediciones Callejón y cuya versión original en inglés fuera merecedora de destacados premios de la Academia estadounidense, por ejemplo, el Frederick Douglass Prize de la Universidad de Yale, el John Hope Franklin Prize de la American Historical Association y los premios de la Gulf South Historical Association y el Kemper y Leila Williams de la Louisiana Historical Association. Y por si fuera poco, acaba de salir en el día de hoy, precisamente está saliendo su más reciente libro, Freedom Papers: An Atlantic Odyssey in the Age of Abolition. Esta vez, que lo tienen aquí en pantalla, la carátula, esta vez como coautora con Jean-Michel Girard, por Harvard University Press en inglés y por Gallimard, que saldrá el próximo año en francés. Así es que nos honra esta estudiosa. Dedicada a examinar minuciosamente la esclavitud, su abolición y la posemancipación en América, en particular en la región del Caribe. Estos estudios han florecido enormemente con las contribuciones de Rebeca Scott, ya que pues, ella tiene artículos en las principales revistas, entre muchas otras, de Francia, de Estados Unidos, de América. Y tiene otros libros en coautoría con Thomas Holt, Frederick Cooper, tiene libros con Luis Pérez. Su primer libro, Slave Emancipation in Cuba, The Transition to Free Labor, 1860-1899, publicado por Princeton University Press en 1985, es un clásico que ha requerido una segunda edición en el año 2000 y cuenta con traducciones al español y al portugués. Y yo creo que es un libro que la mayor parte de los estudiosos de historia pues, hemos leído y por lo menos yo pues, nos hemos formado en él. Mediante convincente y puntilloso microanálisis, Rebecca Scott ha venido presentando argumentos sobre el papel de los esclavos en los procesos de la abolición y en la posemancipación, sus propuestas revisionistas a la forma en que se había interpretado la vida y función de los esclavos en las plantaciones azucareras y sus consecuencias en la posemancipación, todas se han convertido en temas obligados en las discusiones subsiguientes. La fortaleza que ha aportado el microanálisis al desarrollo de estos temas es realmente sorprendente. Últimamente, las aportaciones al estudio del marco legal en el que se desenvuelven esclavos y emancipados han sido decisivas. De manera que, sin más preámbulos, damos una calurosa bienvenida a Rebecca Scott.
Muchas gracias, Astrid. Es un gran placer estar aquí con ustedes. Quiero agradecer a los colegas del Instituto y el Departamento, a Astrid Cubano, a Luisa Graíta, a Humberto García Muñiz y a Juan Justi por haber leído todo este libro en page proofs, ¿no? Antes de que aparezca para poder hacer el comentario. Es un gran placer estar aquí con ustedes. Ahora, espero que me van a perdonar si hablo en mi idioma original, aunque en la parte que es discusión después, con preguntas y discusiones, podemos volver al castellano. It feels strange though to go back to English. So what I'd like to talk about today is to focus on the concept of public rights and to look at this concept as it emerged from the historical record. It emerged in part as I was working on the book Grados de Libertad, the one that Callejón has received, I think, by FedEx this morning, 40 copies direct from the publisher in Colombia. What I hear is that we were competing with the roses coming for Valentine's Day for space in airplanes coming from Colombia. Y ganaron primero las rosas y luego el libro, ¿no? So we'll be doing the lanzamiento of that tomorrow at La Tertulia, 7 o'clock. And so as I was doing the research on Grados de Libertad, I came across these discussions of the concept of public rights. In the usual training that we do in legal thinking and legal concepts, public rights is not, in fact, a concept that's usually presented as part of the 19th century conceptualization of rights. We're usually taught that there's a sequence of basic civil rights, such as the rights to contract, to sue and be sued, that there are political rights, and then that there are social rights. This is the usual tripartite division. And the concept of public rights, with exactly those words, seems to have been introduced in part from Europe and to have entered into the American lexicon, the US lexicon, in part through Louisiana, although there's still much to be done to figure this out. And it was a way of encompassing a broader range of claims to right than would be encompassed within the simpler sense of property rights or the right to sue or even the right to vote. And so we'll talk as we go along about that. But what was particularly interesting to me and what bridges over to this next project, the one called Freedom Papers, is the question, where did this concept come from? Not in the sense of where did it derive from in intellectual history, but how did ordinary people engaged in struggles come to see these rights as fundamental, as something worth fighting for, as something worth taking risks about. So as I finished Grados de Libertad, this question was still open in my mind. How did individuals choose to put this concept of respectful treatment in public space, that in each space in which there was a public component, there should be no distinctions made according to race? So this question was still open in my mind. I had found the concept, I'd found it in the Louisiana Constitution, but I didn't really know how it had emerged. Then I was doing work in the Archivo Nacional in Havana, as I usually do every February and March, and my colleague Marial Iglesias from Havana said to me, Rebecca, you know, in this box of materials you're going through, the Correspondencia de Máximo Gómez, there's a strange letter. She said, there's a letter that doesn't seem to belong there. She said, it talks about Cuba and Louisiana and Haiti. She said, you'd better go look at it. So I put aside the boxes I was working on, which were letters of veteranos of the Cuban War of Independence to Máximo Gómez, expressing their hopes for citizenship, and I went and looked at the letter Marial had seen. And it didn't make any sense. It was a letter, it was, Ovidio, let's see if I can figure out how to do this. Here we go, whoop. I told Ovidio, en caso de urgencia, digo, Ovi, ya, está bien. Está bien. Sí. So this letter, it was peculiar from the very beginning because it's written on the letterhead of a Belgian cigar merchant. So it's not a Cuban veteran in Cienfuegos writing saying, you know, why do I have no rights and no work? Instead, it's a cigar merchant from Belgium. It's written in English. It's the only letter in the Máximo Gómez papers I know of that's written in English. It's typed with a purple typewriter ribbon. Don't know why that was there. And it is a commercial request to the general. So it's the kind of document that might have been thrown away by an archivist who was sorting through the great papers of the great Máximo Gómez. They might have thrown away the request from a Belgian cigar merchant, but luckily they didn't. So he begins with the formal address. In early and ardent sympathy with the Cuban cause, I have always been and pride myself in being still one of your most sincere admirers. This is how you begin a letter when you want to ask for a big favor. I would be highly honored should you have the kindness to authorize me to use your illustrious name for a brand of my best articles, your portrait adorning the labels whereof a proof is enclosed. So a Belgian tobacco merchant wants to put a famous man from Havana on the label of his cigars. No big surprise there. He wants to persuade people in Belgium to associate his cigars, which I should say parenthetically, I now know are made with Mexican tobacco rolled in Antwerp. He wants them to be properly associated with Cuba. But look how he proceeds to try to persuade the general to say yes. He says, I may not be altogether unknown to some of the survivors of the last struggle. And so he's making reference to the 30-year struggle for independence in Cuba. They may remember me as a member of Company C, 6th Louisiana Volunteers, Banks Division in 1863. And when I saw this, I thought, how can this be? The 6th Louisiana Volunteers, Banks Division, these are men of color in the Union Army. So this makes even less sense. This is a Belgian cigar maker. He's saying he was in this unit. He says he was in the Constitutional Convention of the State of Louisiana in 1867-68, elected from the 6th Ward, which is Faubourg Tremé. Is anyone here watching the HBO series Tremé? Yes, Juan Hernandez is watching the HBO series. Faubourg Tremé, multiracial neighborhood with strong working class artisan political background. And then he mentions that he was a cigar manufacturer in Mobile, Alabama from 1869 to 1877. So he's implying that he was in contact with Cuban revolutionaries in exile. They may remember me, he says. So there seem to be three episodes of his life that he wants Gomez to know about. That he's a veteran of this unit of men of color who fought on the Union side. They fought against the Confederacy. That he was a delegate to the Louisiana Convention. That's the convention that wrote the most radical state constitution, I think, in the history of the United States in the 19th century. And that he later made his living as a cigar manufacturer in Mobile, one of the ports on the Gulf of Mexico, to which revolutionary Cuban cigar workers had emigrated during the period of Spanish repression. So I'd read the letter, and I thought, well, how does a man from Belgium end up involved in all this? But there are some clues. Here's what he writes. He says, born in France in 1841, I am of Haitian descent. So he's signaling Haiti. As both my father and mother were born at Gonaïves at the beginning of this century. That's a coded reference. What was born at the beginning of the 19th century in Gonaïves, Saint-Domingue is the Haitian nation. That's where independence was proclaimed. Then he says, my father, although in modest circumstances, left Louisiana for France with the only object in view of raising his six sons in a country where no infamous laws or stupid prejudices could prevent them from becoming men. So there's the signal of the anti-racism, the departing from antebellum Louisiana to France, to the land of the rights of man. So with this sequence of references to Haiti, to stupid prejudices, to Cuban freedom struggles, he was in effect signaling to General Gomez. Gomez himself had spent time in New Orleans in 1884 with Antonio Maceo, also in Faubourg Tremé. Most folks in Faubourg Tremé would be interested to know that Antonio Maceo was there. And I think that Tinchon, Edward Tinchon, is trying to signal anti-slavery, anti-racism, and a commitment to revolutionary ideals of sovereignty. So at the end of reading this letter, I thought to myself, and this is the sort of fantasy life of a historian. I thought, well, the letter may be true or false. This man may be a big liar. But if he's not lying, then this letter seems to give us a kind of Atlantic vision of the long 19th century. You know, usually in European history, we study the long 19th century from the French Revolution to World War I in Europe. But this would be a different long 19th century. This one would be from the Haitian Revolution through 1848 in France, to the American Civil War, and importantly, Reconstruction, and then it would touch down again in the 30-year struggle for Cuban independence, and the letter is written in 1899. So it is a different picture of the 19th century. So I thought to myself, if it could somehow be made to be true, if somehow the story behind this could be as rich as one would dream it might be, we would have a different way of thinking about race and racism, about equal rights, about national sovereignty, as these ideas circulated among unknown people. Because Edouard Tinchon, who signs this letter, he is a strictly unknown person. I think maybe his name appears in one time in one book ever written before this project. So to try and figure out who he was, the first thing was to go to the minutes of the Constitutional Convention, of the Louisiana Convention, and sure enough, he was there, and more importantly, he was an active and vocal member of that Constitutional Convention. It turns out that after finishing his service in the Union Army, he became the director of a school for freed children, for the children of recently freed, of those who'd recently been freed from slavery and children themselves freed from slavery. And with that reputation, I assume, presumably among the parents of those children and his reputation as a Union veteran and his family name, the family was already active in cigar making in Louisiana, he was elected to the Constitutional Convention. And he was vocal in defense of equal public rights. This was the phrase, the equal treatment of all citizens. And this is 1867, so this is 100 years before laws of this kind were passed in the federal Congress, 100 years earlier. In any place of public accommodation, on any public transportation, in any business holding a license from the state, any bar, any corner store, any restaurant, there should be no distinction of color made in service. In other words, already just 2 years out of slavery, this convention is saying that the imposition of color stigma, trying to rebuild distinctions of color on the wreckage of slavery after the war, should be stopped before it starts. It should be prevented. There should not be a stigmatizing separation. He also argued for modifying the tax system on land in Louisiana in such a way as to encourage planters to make land directly available to former slaves as renters or as owners. So he wanted to help with the other great struggle, which was to put resources into the hands of former slaves. So he's visible on the floor of the convention, and the other issue that he feels intensely about is the rights of women. He steps up. The first thing he proposes is that they should fly the flag from sunrise to sunset over the building. Why is this important? It's the stars and stripes in the former Confederate city. It's a direct assertion of the Union victory and of federal supremacy in a city in which Confederate nostalgia is already strong. So that's his first proposal. But the second thing he argues for is that the Constitution that they are about to write should provide for the legal protection in this state of all women in their civil rights without distinction of race or color, without reference to their previous condition. And what was his particular concern within the field of women's rights? That there should be recognition of the legitimacy of marital unions that had not been formalized by legal marriage before. Because, of course, under the Civil Code of Louisiana, prior to the Civil War, there could be no marriage across what was seen as a color line. So any union between two people of different color categories was considered null and void. So his insistence is that all of those unions should be fully and retroactively legitimated as marriages. He wanted to insist that women, independent of their color, could sue for breach of promise of marriage. So they could insist that the men with whom they lived actually go through with formalization of marriage, and that if they should also be able, after 1 year of cohabitation, to oblige the other person to marry them. Now, this did not pass through I can see Maria del Carmen smiling. This did not pass through the legislature. It's contrary to the contractual understanding of marriage and contrary to the religious understanding of consent. So it wasn't going to get passed into law. But it's symbolically very interesting. Symbolically, he's saying the women who have been stigmatized as concubinas, as being in concubinato, should be able now to formalize that as marriage. And this eagerness, he's a 26-year-old young man standing up in New Orleans, Louisiana, to speak about cross-racial unions and to speak about obliging men to marry. It's not what you usually expect a 26-year-old guy to be in favor of. So the driving question then behind the research as we began to trace the history of this family was, where did these conceptions of rights come from? Why did they struggle for the things they struggled for? All we had at the beginning was just Edouard Tinchamp and his self-presentation, the purple typewriter ribbon. And Juan Hernandez was remembering that he heard me speak about this 4 or 5 years ago. At that point, we had just tiny threads of evidence. So we decided that we would try to figure out whether it was possible to go backwards in the family history to understand where this 26-year-old developed these strong views, particularly about marriage and about cross-racial unions. And it was possible in the notarial archives of Louisiana to find the marriage contract of his parents, Jacques Tinchamp and Elizabeth, who had married a woman named Elizabeth. And in the contract, it's a standard marriage contract. We read it. It explained that Elizabeth was from Saint-Domingue. Jacques had been born in the United States. Then over in the margin, if some people here work with protocolos notariales, probably some of the researchers have, you know how sometimes years later someone writes something in the margin that says ver, so the marriage contract was 1822, and then in 1835 someone had written ver, or to see, rectification du nom de l'épouse Tinchamp. Rectification of the name of the spouse of Tinchamp. It gave the book and the page. Rectification of the name? What is this? So I went to that book and that page. And there we see that at the age of 36, the mother of Edouard Tinchamp had gone to a notary to say, in my marriage contract, I was identified only as Elisabeth. No apellido, no surname. She was... We didn't know yet why, but she had no surname. And so now at the age of 36, she says, I want to come claim the surname of my father It's true that I was born a natural child outside of marriage, but my father was present at the baptism and identified himself as my father at the baptism. So she presented a copy of her baptismal register, and the notary, of course, carefully copied it down. So suddenly, we had gone back one generation, now we could go back two, because we had the baptism of Edward's mother, so we had the names of his maternal grandparents. And this copy was of a baptismal certificate drawn up in 1799, so at the end of the 18th century, in the midst of the Haitian Revolution, in the town of Jérémy in Saint-Domingue. So Jérémy, let me see if I can, can I leave the mic? Have we got sound? Yes, okay. So the town of Jérémy, which is on the north coast of the southern peninsula of the colony of Saint-Domingue. So all of a sudden, this phrase, I am of Haitian descent, made more sense, and it moved it away from Gonaïve. I think Gonaïve was a fantasy, a symbolic fantasy, and it moved it to Jérémy. But the interesting thing about this birth, about this baptismal certificate, was that it carried the names then of this original generation. So the signature by the father, which was important to this purpose, was Michel Vincent. We later figured out he was a French colonist. And the reference to the mother was to Marie-Françoise, dite Rosalie, so a woman named Marie-Françoise, whose nickname was Rosalie, and then she was listed as Négresse Libre. So we knew that the grandmother then was a black woman who was free in 1799. Now, at this point, I should say, because I think it's interesting from the point of view of technique, that we made a mistaken interpretation. Historians don't usually tell you what they got wrong, but we had probably seen too many telenovelas and read too many books of history, so we assumed that Michel Vincent would be a rich Frenchman and that Rosalie must have been his slave, maybe his beautiful young slave, whatever. We imagined that that was it. We figured, yeah, that's the story we usually hear. But we knew also to try to dig further. So using that information, just those little clues, Michel Vincent and Marie-Françoise dite Rosalie, we tried to figure out how to go deeper. So we knew somehow this family had gotten from Jérémy and Saint-Domingue to New Orleans. So we guessed that they would have gone through Cuba, because as you know, when war refugees left Saint-Domingue during the Revolution, many of them went right to Santiago, Cuba. And we knew that the Mormons had microfilmed some of the records of the French consul in Santiago. This is the kind of arcane detail you need to know. Ada Ferrer reminded us. She said, the Mormons have microfilmed those. So you order up the microfilm, you go out to the Church of Latter-day Saints, you crank through the microfilm, and sure enough, there was Michel Vincent depositing his last will and testament. And then you keep cranking and cranking. And then there was a little entry, Enregistrement de Liberté de Marie-Françoise, Registry of the Freedom Paper of Marie-Françoise. And I thought, maybe that's her. Maybe that's her. Maybe this is her freedom paper. This was the index. Now, luckily, I didn't remember that there were 500,000 enslaved people in Saint-Domingue and that Marie was the most common name and Françoise was the second most common name. If I had thought about it, I would have given up, but I didn't think about it. I'm sort of an enthusiast. I got on the plane and went to France and went and found the original document, you know, and opened it up and read through the freedom paper, you know, patiently copying it down and then turned the page and it signed Michel Vincent. That was her. So we had now the freedom paper of Edward Tinchon's grandmother. More important, so we knew how she had, well, we thought we knew how she'd become free. More important, her name is rendered a little differently. Marie-Françoise, dite Rosalie, same language, Négresse, same term, de Nation Poulard. De Nation Poulard. I assumed this was an African ethnicity, but I didn't know much about it. Got back on the plane to go home to Michigan, walked over to my colleague Mamadou Diouf from Senegal, and I said, Mamadou, can you tell me, what is Poulard? And he said, Rebecca, it's about 5 million people in Senegambia. It's the second largest ethnicity. Why are you asking? I said, well, because now we think that the grandmother of Edouard Tinchon is a woman de Nation Poulard. Now, Nation Poulard, if you go to one of the most important histories of Senegambia, you'll find this beautiful watercolor. This is a jeune femme de Nation Poulard. This is a Poulard woman. It's generally people who were Muslim. They lived in the valley of the Senegal River. This particular document, which I love because there's a caption that says that this young woman is a young widow, and she has gone to the marabout so that he can create for her an amulet, a Quranic verse on paper, ink on paper, to protect her now that she's alone in the world. So we now had a picture of Rosalie de Nation Poulard. Once we knew that she was Poulard, then we knew, of course, that she had come across the Atlantic in the Middle Passage as a slave. And this is another watercolor. This is the boat called the Marie Séraphique. We have no way of knowing on what boat Rosalie actually came, because, of course, her surname, her name is effaced in any record of a ship, because she'd be considered simply cargo. But this is a classic image of a slave ship, and you can tell it's a slave ship because of this barrier, which is the barrier behind which the crew takes refuge in the event of an uprising. So the baptismal certificate that had been presented to the notary in Louisiana gave us the path to the woman named Rosalie, the original Atlantic ancestor in some sense, along with Michel Vincent. So what we did then was to try to go back and rebuild the whole story, starting then from Rosalie, beginning with the end of the 18th century, to go forward to reach Edward Tinchon's letter in 1899. So this then was the technique. And we sometimes talk of this, and maybe we'll talk about this with Juan Justi later, as a kind of microhistory set in motion. It uses the techniques of microhistory. We became obsessively concerned with every detail about this family. And I say we, this is myself and my co-author, Jean Hébrard. We would have telephone conversations that would sound like crazy people. Wait. I think the stepfather was there on June 3rd, but the stepmother wasn't there on June 5th. Really? Oh, yes, that's very exciting. So we became, it's a technique you might call microhistory set in motion, or you might call it a well-controlled case of obsessive compulsive neurotic disorder. You have to be a little crazy to use this technique, but it's interesting. And the discipline, the scholarly discipline of the technique comes not from the typicality of the family. We don't begin with a sociological profile and choose an individual who fits the sociological profile. It's almost the reverse. We begin with the individual, and whatever that story uncovers, we have to explain. So it's a discipline. We have to keep explaining even when things don't fit. But it's an individual who is affected by the kinds of forces that are affecting everyone in this society in this period. So we began then to tell the story forward, trying to rebuild it from the beginning with the starting point in West Africa. Now, I won't try to tell you everything that is in a 200-page book about the Tinchon family. I'll just say a little bit about the story going forward. That as many of you know, in the late 18th century, there was an active trade in African captives from the city of Saint-Louis du Sénégal at the mouth of the Senegal River. And so it's quite easy to imagine how Rosalie might have been captured from somewhere in the valley and then sold out of Saint-Louis into Saint-Domingue. But the interesting thing is, when we first identify Rosalie in the records in Saint-Domingue, the stereotypes begin to fall away. She is not purchased by a rich Frenchman. She is not sent to sugar plantations. She is purchased by a man who has recently acquired his own freedom, Alexis Kouba, perhaps himself of Poulard ancestry through his mother, given that name Kouba. And he purchases her after he's bought his own freedom, the freedom of his wife, and the freedom of his mother-in-law. So she comes into a household composed of three people, all of whom have been slaves and are now free. So from the first moment that she sets foot in Saint-Domingue, it's clear that slavery is not necessarily a permanent condition. She's then sold by Alexis Cuba to a woman named Martonne, Marthe Guillaume Alliès, who is a free woman, born free, categorized as black, not categorized as mulatresse, but categorized as négresse, categorized as black. And Martonne is one of the wealthiest women in town. She's a trader, and she loans money to people. Almost everybody in town owes money to Martonne. She's a very powerful woman, and she buys and sells slaves. She purchases Rosalie and brings her into the household. Now, as the Haitian Revolution unfolds, we find that Rosalie is not freed by the classic abolition of 1793-94 because she's down in the south and the British army comes in and takes control over the southern part of the colony. So she stays held in slavery even after Toussaint and his forces have worked with the French National Assembly and the civil commissioners to end slavery in the northern part. So she's in the British-controlled part of Saint-Domingue. But Martonne decides to free her through an act of manumission. But that act of manumission, to be valid, needs the signature of the English governor. So we went to look for the records of the English governor that are in the archives in London. And sure enough, we found a letter from Governor Williamson to Martonne saying, "No, it's not convenient that you should be freeing people now, and I will not authorize this freedom paper." So now we begin to realize in legal terms how complicated it is to say whether someone is slave or free. If you are held as a slave and the person who claims a property right over you relinquishes it, then in some sense you're not a slave anymore. But you don't have a signed manumission paper, you're not free either. You're in a kind of intermediate situation. So we begin to see Rosalie, you'll see how the argument develops, we begin to see Rosalie in a situation where she will have to fight to maintain her freedom because she does not have an authorized manumission paper, but she also doesn't have a master. She doesn't have anyone owning her. This is when we began to realize that Michel Vincent was not a rich Frenchman and she was not the beautiful concubine, that these were ordinary people facing ordinary difficulties. She seems to have gone to live with this man named Michel Vincent. She was not his slave. She was by that point, in 1799, free under French law. When the British leave, abolition is extended to the whole colony. So what happened next? The revolution, as you know, achieved the permanent end of slavery, the Haitian Revolution. But Napoleon was very unhappy with the autonomy that Toussaint exercised. And in 1802, Napoleon sent an expeditionary force to defeat Toussaint. Is the student who's writing on Toussaint here? Danel? Is Danel here? No. No, but Danel is working on the subject of Toussaint and the expedition. So the expeditionary force arrives, Napoleon hopes to force the black generals to submit. It's a complete catastrophe. It brings war to the colony. It does not bring victory to Napoleon, and it destroys the peace of the colony. Actually, Napoleon apparently on his deathbed said, "My biggest mistake was to send an expeditionary force to try to defeat Toussaint." And this, from a man who invaded Russia in the winter, to say his biggest mistake was the invasion of Saint-Domingue, this is a big concession. But it created an enormous conflict in the colony, and it sent 18,000 refugees fleeing from the colony. And this is, as we've said a moment ago, you can see the geography of it. People who were fleeing across the Caribbean, where there were British boats patrolling, there was wartime, they were lucky if they could make it to Santiago, Cuba. So Michel Vincent himself, as a refugee, decides to go back to France. and he's not going to take Rosalie or their children with him. And so it's at that moment that he, probably persuaded by her, writes a false manumission paper. He is not her owner. There's no slavery legally, and he doesn't own her. He can't own her. But she needs a freedom paper. So in a sense, he invents the slavery from which to free her. He invents the ownership, which he will relinquish. And he writes, I, Michel Vincent, own Rosalie de Nation Poulard. I hereby free her and her four children, of which, of course, one is Elisabeth, the woman who will go on to become Edward's mother. So we realize that what we had thought was a freedom paper is actually an artifact. It's like that talisman made by the marabout for the Poulard woman. It's something you can hold on to, and maybe it will help you keep your freedom because you're leaving the only country in the Caribbean that has abolished slavery. You're going to countries that have slavery. So to carry our story forward quickly, she goes to Santiago. In the end, Michel can't find a boat for France. He goes with her to Santiago. Elizabeth goes with them. We're not sure about the other children. So in Saint-Domingue, the refugees live in Santiago, and as far as we can tell, Rosalie maintains her freedom. But 1809, Napoleon again. He invades the Iberian Peninsula. The Spanish authorities in Cuba expel everyone they see as having French nationality, which includes the 18,000 emigres. So once again, a forced migration. Now, you will usually read that the emigres who are sent out go to Louisiana. That's true for Elisabeth. We know it's going to be true because we know the family will be in Louisiana. It's not true for Rosalie. She puts her little girl, who's 11 years old, in the care of a godmother to go to Louisiana. But Rosalie, who is an African woman, knows that it would be quite imprudent for her to go to the city that is on its way to being the biggest slave trading center in the United States. And so Rosalie returns to independent Haiti, the one place where she can be sure of citizenship and freedom. And Elizabeth goes as a little girl in the protection of a godmother. So at this point, we realize that she is arriving in, Elizabeth is arriving in Louisiana in the care of a godmother, and the story then begins to pick up. She meets the young man named Jacques, they sign a marriage contract, and they live as free people of color in Louisiana. Now, the situation of Jacques Tinchon, can I shift back to this one? Is that okay? You got sound? Yeah. The situation of Jacques Tinchon in Louisiana, I'll wait for a moment to do the pictures. The situation of Jacques Tinchon in New Orleans, he is a carpenter. He purchases small pieces of land, builds small houses, and sells them. So the family gradually accumulates a certain amount of security, and they have five children. So they have, these are the children about whom Edouard Tinchon will later write. But the situation in New Orleans, Louisiana, in the 1830s is becoming very difficult. There are more and more repressive laws that are being passed by the Louisiana legislature, and it is at this point, as we know from Edward's letter, that his parents decide to leave Louisiana and to try their luck in France. It's a complicated story, but Jacques Tinchon's stepfather has ties with France, and it's at this point that they leave, as we say, to escape what Edward would describe as the infamous laws and stupid prejudices of Louisiana. Now, when they arrive in France, the children are able to go to school. They learn rhetoric, they learn French, they get a good education, but the economy is completely flat. And so several of those sons in the end return to Louisiana, really for financial reasons, I think, hoping to make a fortune. And it's at that point now that the story comes back together, that it intersects with that service in the Union Army. But we still were not quite sure
how to think about the connection between Rosalie de Nation-Poulard and Edward Tachon. And toward the middle point of our research, we went back to the question, where did Elizabeth ever get that baptismal certificate? Why at the age of 36 would she suddenly have proof of her father's having signed the baptismal certificate? And so we looked at the passenger lists of ships coming from Haiti to New Orleans, and we found on one of the lists the name Rosalie Vincent. We realized that it was the African-born Rosalie who actually took the risk of coming to New Orleans in order to turn over that paper, and that that, in effect, made it possible for Edward's mother, Elizabeth, to create a kind of marriage where there had been no marriage. She could take that baptismal certificate to a notary and demand that her surname now be recognized. So if we look at the document, in effect, with the forward-looking logic of the family rather than the backward-looking logic of research, we get a sense of the way in which judicially recognized documents and notarial documents become a mechanism by which this family tries to make things true that may not be socially true in the world in which they live. That is to say, they assert rights not recognized at law, the right to have the surname of that father, even though one is an illegitimate child. So they are taking documents, notarized documents, sacramental records, and finding ways to put those documents in circulation, to recopy them, to certify them, to leverage up the power of those documents. So here we might emphasize one of the key conclusions of the project, the observation that it is often the role of these kinds of papers, freedom papers, birth papers, to be what I think a legal scholar would say peremptory, to be documents that take the tangled facts and history behind them and make them moot by putting a new and simpler set of facts on paper. Sometimes people ask us, do we think some of these documents are forgeries? And we try to say, these are documents that are brought into being. They're not exactly forged. They're created through effort on the part of this family. For example, when Michel Vincent wrote, Rosalie is my slave and I hereby declare her free. Well, she wasn't his slave. There was no slavery in Saint-Domingue. But once that document was copied and countersigned, it was the kind of document you could use as a freedom paper in Santiago, Cuba, and maybe not in Louisiana. So we, I think, can see here that starting already two generations back before Edward, Rosalie of the Poulard Nation had a keen awareness of the importance of official paper. Maybe she'd already known this before she left Senegambia. Maybe she learned it in the household of Martin in Jérémie. Martin was a black woman who always had to prove her own freedom every time she wanted to buy or sell or go to a notary. So if you were even a domestic in the house of Martin, we always imagine, you know, if it were a movie, it's not a movie, it's not even a novel, but if it were a movie, there'd be a trunk under the bed, you know, that would have the paper in it. And even if you were a domestic, you'd know Martin is going to the notary today, better pull out the trunk, unlock it, and take out that freedom paper, because without that, no sale, no contract. So we begin to see that slavery is the creation of positive law, and the positive law had been abolished in Saint-Domingue, but freedom is also a creation of positive law for any person of color in a slaveholding society. So it was by bringing documents into being that members of this family created, in some sense, the law that they needed to maintain their freedom. If we then look forward to Louisiana, Elizabeth, Rosalie's daughter, was secure in her freedom. Her godmother was a woman of color who was authoritative and had a good deal of money. But Elizabeth needed respectability. To be just Elizabeth with no apellido was always to signal that her mother had been a slave, that her father was not married to her mother. So she too takes a piece of paper, a copy of a baptismal register, and leverages it up, uses it by taking it to the local notary and asking him to inscribe a surname for her so that in all future transactions, she will be a proper woman, Elizabeth Vincent, with a paternal surname. So with it, I think it takes just one extra stepping stone to convey something of the complexity of the world out of which Edward Tachon's convictions emerge. And that is, in that same year, when Elizabeth went to the notary with the sacramental record, we kept wondering, can we be sure that it's the same Rosalie Vincent who came from Haiti? It seemed as though it must have been, but how could we prove it? We went into the sacramental records of the Archdiocese of New Orleans, and we found that Elizabeth and Jacques had had a little baby that year, and they'd taken the baby to be baptized. And so there's the baptismal record. So the parents are Jacques Tachon, Elizabeth Vincent, now with her surname. The godfather is one of Jacques Tachon's half-brothers. And the godmother, standing there at the baptismal font, is Rosalie, the woman born in Senegambia, transported as a slave, acquiring her freedom in Saint-Domingue, defending it in Santiago, regaining it in Haiti, and now taking the risk of being in New Orleans. So as Edward's letter to Maximo Gomez had suggested, soon after this baptism, Jacques Tachon and Elizabeth Vincent left New Orleans for France, and Edward himself was born there and went to school there. And he developed his politics in the world of 1848 in France. But when he came back to Louisiana, when he fought in the Union Army, when he entered that constitutional convention, when he argued for absolute public rights, absolute equality of treatment, and respect for marital unions that had not been recognized at law, I think we could say that he was carrying a long Atlantic history on his shoulders. We don't know how much his mother, Elizabeth Vincent, had told him about her own past, and we have no idea how much she might have revealed about Edward's grandmother, Rosalie de Nation Poulard. But Edward, on the floor of the Louisiana Constitutional Convention, described himself as a son of Africa. And this is particularly interesting. This is a portrait of Edouard Tachon. So he was someone who, as a cigar maker, he could go upriver to Memphis, he could pass for white, he could deal with the most elite buyers of cigars. But when he came back down to New Orleans, when he represented himself as a political man, he described himself as a son of Africa. He embraced that side of his family's history. And I think we could say that along the way, Edward had learned a key lesson, in part from the women of his family, about the workings of law and honor. If you want to secure freedom and acquire respect, put it down on paper, build the file, make it true in writing. In each of these three generations, members of the Vincent Tachon family had glimpsed this truth about the ground level of law in slaveholding societies. They had grasped that one purpose of formal writings is to override whatever underlying facts may be beneath them. If a piece of paper backed up by law, a sale document off a boat coming from Senegambia, could turn a human being into a person with a price, it's perhaps not astonishing that Rosalie of the Poulard Nation learned that one could, on occasion, create a piece of paper that would turn a human being into a person of standing. And Edward then, two generations later, hoped that an even more consequential piece of paper, a new state constitution, could secure for an entire population the rights that members of his family had fought for one by one. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Scott, for a really fascinating lecture. Now we will have Dr. Juan Justi Caldero of the Department of History making the comment.
We're trying to anyway. Buenas tardes. Muchas gracias por la invitación al profesor Humberto García, al Instituto de Estudios del Caribe, a Rebeca, a profesora Rebeca Scott, por el interés en que comentara su ponencia. Yo no había leído la charla antes de... sí leí el libro con muchísimo interés, Freedom Papers, me lo envió en manuscrito. También leí más rápidamente Degrees of Freedom en inglés, ¿verdad?, que está saliendo la traducción ahora. Realmente los libros se complementan, uno es más Grados de Libertad, presenta más la historia en macro y más bien después de la Guerra Civil y en Cuba y vinculando con el caso de Cuba, mientras que Freedom Papers es la historia, pues como ella la narró, de manera tan apretada pero tan completa. Yo trataré de abordar algunos de los aspectos del trabajo, del proyecto de ella, reflejado sobre todo en el libro, y que estuvo, que ella abordó en la charla. Y voy a destacar sobre todo el aspecto de Luisiana, porque me parece bien interesante en los años inmediatamente después de la Guerra Civil, porque me parece que es un tema que está insuficientemente conocido en nuestro medio histórico, y que la profesora Scott realmente nos demuestra la importancia de ese episodio en la historia del Atlántico, de Luisiana. Pero para hablar un poco sobre el proyecto más generalmente, pues mis comentarios, reacciones, es que se trata de una historia de una familia y una red familiar para quienes los significados de la libertad y la esclavitud eran realidades inmediatas, que navegaron definiciones cambiantes en tiempo y espacio para trazar un itinerario de desplazamiento, resistencia y esfuerzo económico familiar, que configuró incluso una cadena mercantil en el tabaco en particular, en algunas décadas de la última parte del siglo XIX, con lentos éxitos y casi fracasos, llegó a incluir hasta la producción de tabaco en México, hasta la manufactura en Bélgica. O sea que hay una dimensión económica también interesante en esto, que fue parte del propio esfuerzo de búsqueda de la libertad, ¿verdad? La parte de la dimensión de económica y utilizando redes que cruzaban el Atlántico. El libro demuestra muy hábilmente cómo la gran destreza que tuvieron en la construcción de esas redes transatlánticas, tanto para garantizar la seguridad material de la familia, como para desarrollar toda la actividad que es ya la segunda parte de la historia. Se concentra en tres generaciones de los Tanshan, sobre todo en la historia de dos de los cinco hermanos, Edward, pero también Joseph, su hermano, el segundo de los seis hermanos, que fue posiblemente el que tuvo más éxito económico y el que se establece con mayor permanencia en Bélgica. Joseph realmente es el que tiene la presencia en París en el 1848. Joseph tiene la presencia más de lleno allí. Acababa de estudiar, acababa de terminar el liceo. Sus fechas son prácticamente las mismas que las de Betances, y volveré un poco a eso. 1827, el año de nacimiento de Betances, que también está circulando por París ahí en los 1848 y principios de los 50, y muere un año después de Betances en el 1899. Ciertamente ofrece la conexión que se establece entre la Revolución Haitiana, el 1848, la Guerra Civil y sus secuelas en Luisiana, la Guerra de Independencia Cubana tangencialmente a través del interés de Edward, pues nos presenta esa historia, me parece que eso el libro lo logra muy bien, es presentar como una visión alterna del siglo XIX, que obviamente tiene que estar conectada con la que conocemos mejor, esta que va de la Revolución Francesa hasta la Primera Guerra Mundial. Pues aquí se trata de la Revolución Haitiana hasta la Guerra Cubana de Independencia, a los 30 años, realmente, y ahí verdaderamente nos permite poner al Caribe en una posición mucho más central que la que nos permite la historia en grande esta que generalmente escuchamos, que está dirigida sobre todo al espacio europeo. Quería comentar sobre las partes de primera parte del libro. Saint-Domingue, y vamos a pasar a Luisiana rápidamente, me pareció interesante de las partes de Saint-Domingue la idea de que Saint-Domingue mismo y la revolución allá tuvo una dimensión regional importante, y lo que está pasando en una parte de Saint-Domingue no es lo mismo que está pasando en otras. La península donde se desarrolla la primera parte del libro es la península que le llaman el sur en Haití, es una península larguísima, más larga de lo que uno piensa, es el doble de largo de Puerto Rico, tiene 200 millas de largo y la mitad del ancho de Puerto Rico, así que es como una proyección tremenda que tiene Haití hacia el Caribe, y ciertamente en la punta de la península donde está Jeremy, donde está Abrico, donde ellos viven también, es un área que está muy sumida en ese Caribe que nos interesa tanto, que es el que Puerto Rico estuvo más, un Caribe donde la plantación azucarera no era lo predominante necesariamente, donde había café, que era lo que predominaba allí, y mucha actividad de contrabando. El grado de libertad que Rosalí logra tener y que las personas con quien ella convive logran tener en esa parte de Saint-Domingue tiene que ver con el carácter de la región del sur y de la península, el extremo de la península, que tiene, que son características que se encontraban en otras partes de Haití también, pero que quizá en esas áreas se encontraba más, con más intensidad, a diferencia del norte, del gran valle del norte, donde están concentradas los cientos de miles de esclavos que están trabajando en las plantaciones azucareras. O sea que nos abre una ventana a una historia, una manera de ver la historia de Haití que me parece bien interesante, y luego cuando viene la revolución, los procesos en la parte de la península, es donde predominan los mulatos bajo Rigaud, es donde invade el ejército inglés, donde se pospone la libertad para los esclavos algunos años. Y tiene su propia dinámica, me pareció bien interesante. La parte de Luisiana, cuando inicialmente llegan a Luisiana, la profesora Scott, por cuestión de tiempo, pues habló rápidamente. Cuando ellos llegan a Luisiana, Luisiana está en medio del proceso de pasar de territorio a Estado. Y entonces la situación legal es aún más compleja, porque no estaba muy claro cuál era el estatus de la esclavitud de Luisiana como territorio. Y hay toda una pugna entre la gente libre de color y los anglos que están llegando sobre Luisiana, si se va a convertir o no en Estado, y cuál va a ser el estatus de la esclavitud en todo eso. O sea que lo que nos pone a pensar el libro realmente es en toda la complejidad, las dimensiones tremendamente históricas que tiene la esclavitud, fuera de las definiciones a veces muy, muy acartonadas que se ofrecen. Luisiana, realmente los trabajos de la profesora Scott ya desde lo primero que ella trabajó sobre Cuba y Luisiana, hacen algo que es muy importante, que me parece que hace falta hacerlo más, y hace falta hacerlo más desde nuestro lado también, que es abrir la historia de los Estados Unidos. La historia de los Estados Unidos se tiende a ver como algo, como lo ven muchos norteamericanos, como algo excepcional, que no se puede verdaderamente conectar ni comparar con otras partes del mundo de una manera muy, muy útil, y que no comparte características verdaderamente provocadoras. Yo creo que el trabajo de la profesora Scott demuestra lo contrario. Aparte y lo hace de una manera muy directa a través de personas que van circulando entre Saint-Domingue, Cuba, Luisiana, luego Francia, etcétera. Pero uno también lo puede ver a nivel de los procesos políticos que se están dando y la importancia que tienen. Lo que pasa en Nueva Orleans después de la Guerra Civil no es chiste. Lo que se sabía era que los esclavos iban a quedar libres, pero más allá de eso no se sabía más nada. Había incluso opiniones del secretario de Justicia de Luisiana que decía que no podían ser siquiera ciudadanos. Aunque fueran no esclavos, no podían ser ciudadanos. Había opiniones del secretario de Justicia Federal que decía que podían ser ciudadanos, pero que no podían tener ningún derecho. Entonces la discusión sobre cuáles son los derechos que pueden tener los ex-esclavos, que incluso cubría a la gente libre de color, porque había la tendencia entre muchos también a negarle también derechos de participación política, se vuelve algo bien dramático en ese contexto, con mucha violencia. Hay, aquí se ganaron derechos o se detuvieron cosas peores a través de confrontaciones donde murieron decenas y decenas de negros y de mulatos, asambleas que trataban de hacer, y venía la policía y les caía encima y mataban a 40. Eso llevó al gobierno en Washington a tener que ir modificando su política y ahí reconociendo unas cosas que inicialmente no estaban muy dispuestos a reconocer. Los confederados estaban volviendo a tomar las posiciones de poder en 1864-65, y eso lo están viendo los negros libres y los exesclavos, los que habían sido libres desde antes y los exesclavos. Así que la constitución de Luisiana que se da en el 1868, la Asamblea Constituyente, se da como el resultado de una tremenda pugna que se venía dando desde 1862, cuando Luisiana primero cayó en manos de las tropas de la Unión, y cuando se había estado discutiendo intensamente cuál iba a ser el estatus de los exesclavos. La discusión de los derechos públicos, pues ciertamente tiene una gran importancia en la constituyente, es la posibilidad de utilizar facilidades como hoteles, como transportación pública, sin ningún tipo de discrimen. Y eso se le estaba cuestionando. Incluso se podía decir que estaban dispuestos a reconocer el voto, aunque eso también se lo hubieran querido quitar, pero estaban dispuestos a reconocer el voto, pero sin poder tener acceso igual a facilidades públicas. Así que esas pugnas en Luisiana tienen un gran interés los resultados no estaban predeterminados. Y hubo realmente un paréntesis de unos 10 años en que los exesclavos y los negros que habían sido históricamente libres pudieron ejercer derechos muy amplios hasta el 1877. Y durante esos años, a costa de mucho esfuerzo y gracias a la Constitución del 68 en parte, los negros y mulatos en Nueva Orleans lograron elegir legisladores, senadores, etcétera, y crearon un precedente que va a tener mucha resonancia en los Estados Unidos en años posteriores. Lo último que quería comentar, para no quitar más tiempo de las preguntas y respuestas, y eso después se pierde, ¿verdad? En los 1880 y 90 se pierde esas victorias que se tuvieron a finales de los 60 y principios de los 70, se pierden, pero queda un legado que se va a ver más adelante. Lo último que quería comentar en cuanto a implicaciones para Puerto Rico que pudiéramos anotar, creo que cómo conecta esto con la trayectoria de Betances me parece que es interesante, porque yo creo que mucho, por ejemplo, los 10 mandamientos de los hombres libres, yo creo que es interesante verlo en el contexto de la discusión sobre derechos públicos, salvando las diferencias de contexto, historia, y los casos insulares. Me parece que para entender los casos insulares, conviene mirar de cerca la historia de los debates sobre la esclavitud en los Estados Unidos, inclusive el caso de Downs versus Bidwell cita a Dred Scott, es la autoridad que principalmente cita, así que es importante entender las controversias que se dieron alrededor de la esclavitud en los Estados Unidos, y luego en lugares como Luisiana, donde estuvieron en pugna, cuáles iban a ser las definiciones post-esclavitud de la ciudadanía, que eso estaba totalmente en el aire en un momento dado, y fue gracias a los esfuerzos de gente como Edward y Joseph Tanchant que lograron establecer una plataforma de derechos públicos que por lo menos por espacio de una década sirvió para demostrar que había otra alternativa, otra forma de vivir en el sur que no fuese la segregación. Muchas gracias.
Si la doctora quiere comentar algo de lo que Juan.
Bueno, me parece que en este momento lo mejor sería. Sí.
Un cambio de cinta por un minuto.
¿Podemos sentarnos acá?
No, siéntese acá.
Sí. Ok. No, vamos directamente a las preguntas, está bien.
Quiero.
¿Hay un problema con él?
Anunciarles que este jueves tenemos el día de Frantz Fanon. Tenemos un documental de 9:30 a 11:30 sobre Frantz Fanon. Y a la 1 tenemos a la hija de Frantz Fanon, Miriel Fanon, y al doctor Nelson Maldonado Torres del Departamento de Literatura Comparada de Rutgers, que hablarán sobre el proyecto inconcluso de la descolonización de Fanon con motivo de los 50 años de su muerte y de la publicación de Los Condenados de la Tierra, de 1 a 3:30 en este salón, y de 9:30 a 11 el documental. Ya. Abrimos ahora para preguntas y comentarios. Les rogamos que por favor sean breves, porque hay otras personas que quieren hacer una pregunta.
Buenas tardes, María del Carmen Valga del Departamento de Historia. Quiero empezar diciendo que lo que hemos recibido hoy en día es una lección magistral de metodología. Y me encanta que mis estudiantes del curso de metodología de la historia, del programa de bachillerato, están aquí. Algunos de ellos ya salieron, pero espero que hayan estado la mayor parte del tiempo, porque pues no todos los días uno tiene el privilegio de oír una presentación como esta. Así que, para empezar, felicitaciones, porque realmente lo que nos ha presentado aquí es me resultó fascinante. Yo tengo una pregunta que tiene que ver quizás con esta idea que me pareció fascinante de los papeles, ¿verdad? De los papeles legales y cómo los papeles legales no es que sean una falsificación, y estoy de acuerdo con eso, no son una falsificación, y usted lo plantea como they come into being, o sea, como que surgen para forjar una nueva situación social. Uh-huh. Pero me pregunto yo hasta qué punto no corresponde eso a unos procesos sociales que reconocen que hay vías socialmente aceptables de cambiar de estatus dentro de estas sociedades atlánticas que estamos estudiando. Porque pensando en el contexto que yo estudio, que es Puerto Rico siglo XIX, y también pensando en todo lo que se ha escrito sobre las colonias españolas, y una gran literatura que hay sobre esos temas, vemos que hay una serie de vías que son socialmente aceptables, en donde unas personas pueden empezar en el escalafón más bajo de la sociedad y auparse. Y muchas veces, pues quizás esa legalización más bien es como la cristalización de un proceso social, ¿verdad?, de lucha y negociación. A ver qué le merece, si puede comentar sobre esto.
Sí, gracias, María del Carmen. Sí, me parece que esto es exactamente el mecanismo que está funcionando, que hay como una relación casi circular entre estatus social, condición legal, prueba en papel, performance de un papel social, de un rol social. Y esto es una temática que es interesante discutir también con Justy, quien tiene formación de abogado y en análisis de derecho y leyes. Frecuentemente pensamos que hay una cosa que es estatus legal y que esto debe ser más o menos fijo, que se podría averiguar si una persona es esclava o libre, cuál es su estatus y a lo mejor ha logrado cambiar su condición. Pero en la verdad, todo esto es, como usted dice, es en un contexto social en que en cierto sentido se lee el estatus mirando la condición. Así que una persona, por ejemplo, que viene como refugiado desde Haití, Santo Domingo, Haití, durante la Revolución, que pasa a Santiago, ¿cómo es que el sistema legal va a reconocer a esta persona como libre o esclava? Bueno, no hay esclavitud en Santo Domingo. Entonces, todos son libres bajo un determinado interpretación de la ley francesa. Pero jamás los administradores de Cuba en esta época van a permitir que miles y miles de ex-esclavos que entren diciendo que tienen su libertad gracias a Toussaint Louverture un ejército de ex-esclavos. Uno no puede bajar del barco y explicar su estatus en estos términos. Uno sería percibido inmediatamente como un riesgo a la seguridad y no le dejarían bajar. Entonces, cada persona tiene que renegociar su estatus. En el caso de Rosalie con Michel Vincent, se supone que su presencia al lado de un hombre blanco en un determinado momento puede haber hecho que a lo mejor ella entró como esclava, pero vivía como libre una vez instalada
No se sabe, ¿no? Pero esto es una cosa muy compleja y que hasta la determinación del estatus legal, libre o esclavo, era una cosa negociada exactamente como usted dice, en un contexto social, y hay muchos casos en que la lucha es una lucha que se pierde. Nosotros podemos seguir la historia de los Tachon en cierto sentido porque lograron mantener su libertad, lograron poner documentos en protocolos notariales. Otras personas, cuando llegan los barcos desde Santiago a la Nueva Orleans en el verano de 1809, 3.226 personas entran como esclavos, aunque esto es contrario a la ley contra la trata, y todas esas personas habrían vivido como libres en Saint-Domingue antes. Entonces, 3.226 personas, en cierto sentido, desaparecen de nuestros horizontes porque no tienen la posibilidad de bring papers into being, de crear una presentación de sí misma como libre. Y luego hay otros casos, y este artículo que en el cual tengo algunas separatas sobre una mujer que llega como libre y luego aparece un vecino de hace algunos años y dice que tiene una deuda con respecto a su ex dueño, ¿verdad? Y la coge como esclava y ella lucha frente.
Bandido.
Sí, es kidnapping, ¿no? Pero si él puede recuperar el papel que ella tiene, que es prueba de libertad, y destrozarlo, ella tendrá una lucha seria para mantener su libertad. Entonces, exactamente como usted dice, todas estas luchas están en un contexto social y político, y el papel es a la vez una arma y también es lo que deja una huella para nosotros para entender la lucha, ¿no?
Quería comentar que es una microhistoria en movimiento, pero sí, es una microhistoria en movimiento, como dice, pero me parece que es una microhistoria en movimiento en un sentido
sí,
vertical también, que cubre diversas escalas, que yo creo que eso le da un sentido mucho más fuerte.
Gracias.
Juan Otero, de Estudios Hispánicos. Un comentario y una pregunta, ¿no? El comentario es, en Absalom Absalom, la novela de Faulkner, habla sobre el hijo perdido, ¿no?, que tiene los esclavos, y él tiene esclavos de Haití, de Santo Domingo, ¿no?, a principios del siglo XIX. Dice que son esclavos que los trajo de allá, y los trajo, tiene que haber sido uno siendo llevando la cronología de la novela, a principios del siglo XIX, que seguramente estos grupos de 3.200 que viajaron, que se convierten en esclavos cuando llegan en Luisiana, son contados así. ¿Cuántos viajaron con los ex amos que recuperan o reclaman su posesión? Y a mí siempre me extrañó eso, ¿no? ¿Cómo posterior a la esclavitud, en esta novela aparece un ciudadano viajando con sus esclavos, ¿no? ¿Cuántos de esos habrán llegado aquí? A pesar de que en Haití abolieron la esclavitud, ¿cuántos vinieron acá después con la cédula de gracias con sus esclavos, ¿no? El origen de nuestra bomba es ese, ¿no? Esa migración de esos personajes con la cédula de gracia, llegar aquí y traer a sus esclavos o a sus ex-esclavos. La pregunta es, en términos de los viajes, yo estoy maravillado en términos de las traslaciones de estos ciudadanos, ¿no? ¿Cuán común y cuán frecuente podían ser los viajes de estos ciudadanos con este estatus tan ambiguo entre lo que era, va a ser Haití, Santiago, New Orleans, ¿no? Porque esa traslación me parece genial, ¿no? Porque es crear un espacio fronterizo de expansión de esos ciudadanos, ¿no? ¿Cuán frecuente eran esos viajes?
Sí, dos preguntas entonces. Bueno, primero sobre la cuestión de utilizar el término esclavos para gente que han vivido como libres en Saint-Domingue. Me parece que aquí hay una culpa compartida entre historiadores que frecuentemente han utilizado este mismo término. Hablan de refugiados de Saint-Domingue con sus esclavos. Me parece que hay historiadores que han hecho el error. Hay momentos de llegada en que alguien, que puede ser el alcalde de Nueva Orleans o alguien, crea una lista y mirando a la gente y a lo mejor hablando un poco con alguien, divide la gente en las categorías de esclavo y libre. Y no hay una base legal para esta división. Cuando se dice que esclavitud, la esclavitud era una institución legal, esto es cierto en un sentido limitado. Tenía forma legal, pero la persona libre que viene entrando en una lista de esclavos al llegar a cualquier lugar, ¿no? A Puerto Rico, a Cuba, a Estados Unidos, está sufriendo un cambio de estatus por un mecanismo que no es legal, no hay un procedimiento para juzgarlo. Entonces, me parece que usted tiene razón, que habría que leer con mucha atención cuando pensamos, cuando hablamos de este periodo, y entender que la distinción esclavo y libre era negociado bajo circunstancias de extrema, de gran dificultad para la persona. Ahora, sobre los viajes, eso es interesante. Tengo una cartografía, yo trabajé con una mujer quien hizo una cartografía de los viajes de los Tanchon y los Vincent. Y como usted dice, es casi increíble, hasta los descendientes hoy de la familia Tanchon nos han dicho, pero ¿cómo es posible que nuestros abuelos cruzaron tan frecuentemente el Atlántico y hicieron estos viajes en el Caribe? Entonces, si uno piensa, los viajes, me parece que hay condiciones diferentes para distintos recorridos. Que San Luis, Saint-Domingue, esto sí que conocemos, sabemos cómo esto sucede, porque esto era como cautiva y enviado por fuerzas comerciales que mandaron africanos a venderse como esclavos. Otros viajes dentro del Caribe, esto de Jeremy a Santiago, esto fue en barcos pagando pasaje en circunstancias de guerra que uno puede imaginar la dificultad. Refugiados tratando de salir de una ciudad en guerra. Luego, cuando ella regresa de Santiago de Cuba a Jeremy, yo me pregunté la misma cosa. ¿Cómo es que Rosalí, una mujer africana que tiene muy pocos recursos, puede lograr ir a Haití, un país que no está reconocido como nación por las otras potencias imperiales? Pues encontré una lista en el archivo en La Habana que habla de pequeños botes. Me parece que la palabra era... no era guairo, una palabra extraña, ¿no? Que, no extraña, pero una palabra que no conocí, para pequeños botes que llevan como 5 o 6 personas y hacen el recorrido corto entre Santiago y Jeremy, llevando madera, llevando pequeños productos de intercambio. Así que hay momentos en que la gente toman realmente casi un barco de fortuna, una oportunidad para moverse. Y luego, con algunos de los recorridos entre Europa y Nueva Orleans, y luego hay toda una parte de la historia de la familia en Veracruz, que ni he tocado, que es otra cosa, ¿no? Es que ellos toman un steerage passage, toman su baúl y pagan por el pasaje más barato. Hay un barco, un steamer a fines del 19, desde Bordeaux, cada semana para Nueva Orleans, para Veracruz y para otro para Río de la Plata. Entonces, estos son recorridos en la época. El agua es un medio de transporte, en cierto sentido, eficiente. Aunque para nosotros ahora es menos común. Uno piensa en barcos de crucero, cosas caras y complicadas, pero en este periodo el agua era el medio de transporte y había distintos niveles. No sé si esto contesta la pregunta de usted, pero hay mucho movimiento. Y esto también en el artículo más reciente de Ada Ferrer sobre el impacto de la Revolución Haitiana, ella habla de hombres marineros de color, esclavos en el estatus de esclavo en Jamaica, que simplemente toman el barco en que trabajan. Un día que el dueño del barco está en tierra y ellos están en el barco, pues salen y van para Haití, y una vez que logran poner los pies en tierra de Haití, están considerados como ciudadanos haitianos y el gobierno haitiano no les va a devolver a los ingleses. Así que hay también una atracción magnética de Haití para la gente cuyo estatus puede ser o de esclavo o ambiguo, ¿no?
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es John Orayambia. Me llamó mucho la atención el concepto del public right,
sí,
porque me parece análogo al más moderno de state action. en el sentido de que para que alguien pueda escribir un derecho frente al Estado, tiene que haber intervenido el Estado. En el caso del public right, no sé si es exactamente lo mismo en forma antigua o si es algo más natural, algo de que lo que es público por naturaleza hay una protección, o si también public right supone que es por una protección que el Estado nos da si entramos en la esfera de lo público. ¿Cuál sería la diferencia?